This is Roll 1 with Michele Cohen-Rodriguez.
This is November 23rd, 1998. The survivor is Michele Cohen-Rodriguez. Maiden name is Rosenberg. The interviewer is Sephora Glass. We are in Santa Monica, California, USA, and the language is English.
My name is Zipporah Glass, G-L-A-S-S. I'm going to be conducting an interview today with Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez. Today is November 23rd, 1998. We are in Santa Monica, California, and the language will be in English. Good morning, Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez.
Good morning.
Could you say your name and spell it, please?
My name is Michele Cohen-Rodriguez, M-I-C-H-E-L-E. Cohen, C-O-H-E-N, and it's hyphenated, Rodriguez, R-O-D-R-I-G-U-E-Z.
And what was your name at birth?
Michele Rosenberg, R-O-S-E-N-B-E-R-G.
And where were you born?
In Paris, France.
What was the year?
The 26th of March, 1935.
And how old are you today?
63.
Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez, what do you know about your ancestry, your grandparents, and going back from there?
Well, the only thing I know is what our parents used to talk about our grandparents, but I never met them. They were killed during the war, and my paternal grandfather was hung by the Germans in Krakow because of his religion, because he was a very religious man. And that's all I know.
So your paternal grandparents were from Poland?
Yes, they were from Krakow. And then my parents came to France.
Did you know their professions?
No.
Or did you know their names?
No.
And how did you find out that information about what happened?
Well, my parents used to speak about them, but on a very light, in a very light matter, because it was very painful for them. My brothers did know them briefly. They traveled to Poland to see them on certain holidays, but very briefly, and then the war broke out, and that was the end of it.
Is there any memorial or marker or gravesite for them?
We have nothing. We only know through papers that came to my parents, but those papers were destroyed during the war.
And on your maternal side, where are those grandparents from?
Also Krakow, and we have nothing. No pictures, nothing.
Do you know how your parents met?
They met... my father was dating my mother for 10 years. That I know. He courted her for 10 years. She must have been 5 years old at the time. And he was in love with her then. She was very beautiful. And... you know, in those years, people just knew other people in the neighborhood. Everybody was living in a Jewish area. So the children married among themselves, you know, from one family to another.
And where did your mother and father grow up?
In Krakow. And then they came to Paris. My father came to Paris, I think, at the age of 18. And then they got married very young.
And what was your father's name?
Chaim Rosenberg.
And your mother's name?
Hannah Borenstein. And they came to Paris. And they lived in Paris.
And what was your father's profession? How did he support
He was involved in a business with threads. linens and things like this, but just the threads. It's called a filature in French. And that's how he supported us.
And what would you say the economic level of your family was when you were a young child?
Middle class. I would say middle class. We had everything we needed.
Did you have brothers and sisters?
Yes, I had three brothers.
Can you tell me their names, starting with the oldest?
Abel, David, and Maurice.
And how much older were they than you?
With my oldest brother, there is 12 years difference. I'm the baby. And he is the only one left now, and myself. My brother Maurice, the youngest one, was 18. When the, first of all, between the three brothers, there was a difference of 18 months in age. And my brother Maurice was deported at the age of 18 to Auschwitz and never came back.
I'm going to ask you questions about that a little bit later, but I wanted to ask you a few things more about your home. What language did you speak at home?
We spoke Yiddish before. I remember that I spoke Yiddish before I spoke French. And I spoke French when I went to maternal school, which is not maternal school, it's called in French. It is called so, but it is nursery school. Then we spoke English. I mean, they're French. But then at home we spoke mostly Yiddish among ourselves. My brothers and I spoke always French. But with my parents, we always spoke Yiddish. Inside the house, when we were outside, we spoke French, all of us.
Was that common in France at the time you were young?
I think every Jewish family spoke Yiddish. At home and outside, they spoke French.
Do you remember your father having papers in Yiddish or books? Or
he read the Yiddish paper, which was called Unser Wort, which is our word, our. I guess that's what that it's translated, and. He read all kinds of Yiddish books, and he was a religious observant person, my mother also. My mother read a lot of Sholem Aleichem stories, and we spoke about the Yiddish culture at home. We had a real warm Yiddish house, observed all the holidays with many, many, many people in the house. We used to have seders of 35, 40 people. Was not unusual.
And who were those people?
We had cousins and friends and from the family, but that was before the war. My father had seven brothers, so consequently there was a big family because they were all married and they had children. So we used to spend every Sunday in somebody else's house, which when I was a child was very boring to me.
And did all those brothers live in Paris?
About, like the close surroundings of Paris, or Paris itself. And we were a very, very close family.
And on your mother's side, did you have extended
family? On my
mother's
side, there was only one sister who was like our second mother. She was, in fact, we called her Mama.
What was her name?
Lily Wagemann was her name. She passed away about seven years ago. She was very close to us. She was a part of our life that was very important. She lived with us until she got married. because her parents, of course, were deported, and she lived with us. And my father made sure that she had a proper wedding and everything, took care of her.
How many cousins would you estimate you had, you know, before the war?
I have only four left. Most of them, a lot of them died after the war, and most of them were deported as children.
Can you tell me a little bit more about where you grew up? Like, would you describe your home? You know, was it a flat or a house, and what neighborhood?
Well, no, it was a house with two floors, and in a very nice neighborhood, very residential, like you would say, Santa Monica, Beverly Hills, a very residential area. And the school was about three blocks away. It was a non-Jewish neighborhood. And for my parents and the family to go to the synagogue, we had to walk about 45 minutes. And the people in the area, everyone knew that we were Jewish, and everybody was very nice to us. During the war, when the war broke out, many of the people who lived in the neighborhood helped us.
What was the name of the neighborhood?
It was just, there was no neighborhood, you know, name like, no, there wasn't. It was the neighborhood of Levallois-Neuilly, that was it.
What was the name of the street that you lived on? The address?
9 bis Rue Voltaire. It was a block away from the subway. It was a beautiful area. Across the street from us was the, and still exists, the English hospital, the British English hospital, which is very famous in France as a very good hospital. And about six blocks away was the American hospital, which was very strange. We had no French hospital around, but we had to go quite a distance to go to a French hospital, which was strange.
Do you know why your parents chose to live in what you describe as sort of a non-Jewish neighborhood?
No, they're just... found that house, and it was a large apartment, and in a two-story house, which was very unusual. And they liked the idea. It was private. There was a little garden in the back, which was very unusual for Paris. I guess they just liked it because it was a nice area.
Did you have contact with the neighbors?
Oh, yes.
And their children?
Oh, yes. Everybody was like, everybody knew everybody, and we knew everything about who got married, who didn't. And we used to go to their weddings. But they never came to our weddings because it was total different cultures. The Jews didn't mingle so much with the Gentiles in Simchas. Except the Gentiles used to invite us, and we would go. But we only went to their receptions. We never went to their religious, for some reason. I don't know why. And they never came to our religious events, like when my oldest brother got married right after the war. They didn't come to the synagogue. But they came to the reception. I don't know why. Probably without any reason.
Do you remember how you felt as a young girl, you know, being Jewish, being, you know, different than those neighbors?
Only in school. In school, I was, I felt different because the directrice, which was the dean, like the dean of the school, was very protective of the Jewish children that were in the school. But there was the young children of my age, some of them were very anti-Semitic.
Would you explain that?
Well, they used to treat us with name-calling. Like they would say, dirty Jew. It was very painful to us. And a couple of times, they beat us up because we were Jewish and we couldn't understand why. But it was probably because France is a very Catholic country. And in those days, they were taught that we killed Christ and, you know, all these nonsense stories. I suppose this is why they, you know, children learn from example. And at home they probably spoke very differently than they thought it should be done. I don't know. Anti-Semitism was very big in France. All the Latin countries of Europe.
Do you remember the name of the synagogue that your parents went to?
Yes, it was called the Little Synagogue of Neuilly. It was a beautiful synagogue.
What are your memories of it?
The smell. It had a very... It smelled of spices. You know, the spices that you smell on Shabbat. And it had a smell of candles also. And I remember that I sat upstairs with my mother. And downstairs, I used to run down. My father was a Kohen. So he had many honors on the Bima, you know, as a Kohen. And I used to run down many times to my father, and my father used to scold me gently, you know, and say, "You go back to your mother." But I liked to be downstairs with my father because it was very impressive to me. It was holy. It meant a lot to me to go to the synagogue when I was a child.
Did you receive a formal Jewish education?
No. Didn't have time. And I resented the fact that we didn't have the First Communion, like all the other children, that my friends, I was invited to the First Communion all the time. They looked like little brides, you know, and I used to resent that a little bit. And then my father said, "You just have to be patient and wait until your wedding day." So I did.
Were you taught Hebrew and prayers?
No. We did everything in Yiddish at home. The boys had, my brothers went to Hebrew school, and they had a melamed at home that came and gave them private lessons. But only actually my mother knew how to read and write Hebrew and read and write Yiddish. And my aunt and the adults, but as far as the children, the girls were not taught that. Only the boys. We didn't mind it.
And what was Shabbat like in your home?
Very important. Shabbat started on Thursday. We started to get ready on Thursday for Shabbat. The cooking, the baking, the big cleaning was going on with the scrubbing, and the Shabbat was beautiful. Friday night, the linens were out, special linens, and the candelabras were shining, and we had help in the house. And they knew what to do, that everything had to be shiny, but no one was allowed to cook except my mother. She would not want anyone, or my aunt, she didn't want anyone to mix up her dishes, and that there shouldn't be any mishap in the kitchen. And I used to help to set the table and things like this. But like I said, Thursday started the cooking and things like that. Shabbat was very important. And I behaved very well on Shabbat. My mother used to say, it would be wonderful if God could make several Shabbats in 1 week, so you would be always on time and listening to me. I was a little mischievous, I guess, more than the boys were, because I was spoiled. It was a good life before the war.
Do you remember your brother's bar mitzvah?
No. I don't remember that. First of all, I have 12 years difference, so I remember my brother's wedding. It was a big, big thing. I was 12 years old at the time. It was beautiful. It was 500 people were at the wedding, and it was after the war. So it was the talk of the city.
Which brother was that?
Abel. David never got married. And Maurice didn't have a chance.
Was Zionism or Israel somehow important to your family?
Yes, my father always spoke about that. My father's the main conversations were about Israel. How important it was to have a state, and that tzedakah was always given for Israel. Everything was geared to that. He belonged to clubs. In hiding, even, they used to go and speak about a movement that they had, but I don't remember the name of it. But it was strictly Zionism. Judaism was everything. Our life was just Judaism. And then when the Germans came in, they just took everything away from us.
Was there any discussion in your family that you remember about living in Israel before the war?
No. Not that I remember. I was too young to remember that. But when my father and mother discussed, they used to speak about Israel, and they said that maybe someday they will go and visit. But there wasn't too much depth into it.
What stands out in your mind of, if you had to think of one incident from that time before the war, what comes to mind? A memory you might have of life before the war?
It was peaceful. It was... odors were very important for me. And it smelled clean. The war left me with a when the war broke out, I felt that everything became very dirty. It was a personal insult to my country that I love France very much, and I felt that the Germans invaded my country and made it and soiled it, and therefore brought out in people's minds horrible things. It was like Machiavellic things. For some reason, it was odors that stand out in my mind. Everything was clean and fresh. And then when the war broke out, it wasn't the same, because we had, first of all, we couldn't even go out during the day. We had certain hours that we were allowed to go out. And as a child, I couldn't go into a park but on certain hours. And the hours were restricted when the sun was gone.
Do you remember how old you were when you first experienced that?
I think about 7, 8 years old. 6 maybe. There was a park not too far from home where my mother used to take me there, and I used to meet my friends there in a certain spot, and we would play under a certain tree. And it was, the park was surrounding the city hall of our area. It was beautiful, with beautiful statues and a lot of art around, and a lot of greenery and flowers. And for some reason, the odors of the flowers disappeared for me when the war broke out, because we couldn't play anymore. We had to be there. There was a sign that says, no Jews and dogs are allowed.
Do you remember that?
Yes. It was written on a ceramic plaque with navy blue letters. And it was, to me, I couldn't understand it. And when I asked my parents explanations, they were dumbfounded themselves. They were shocked by what happened, because although they lived in a country prior to this, prior to France, they lived in an anti-Semitic environment also in Poland. So maybe they thought that coming to France, it would be another culture and it would be different. And then suddenly this happened, and for some reason they just could not speak about it. They couldn't give me explanations. And I never, come to think of it, I never asked my parents, why doesn't the Lord step into all this, you know? I didn't ask anything.
We'll stop here to change tape.
So do you feel we... Wait, just a minute. Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez, what do you remember as being the first thing that happened that made you realize that your life was going to change just before the war?
Just before the war. When we were playing hopscotch in front of the house with my friends, and there was an atmosphere of coldness even in the middle of the summer. People were not so joyful for some reason. The cafes used to be full with people sitting around and sitting in front of a cup of coffee for hours. They still do it. And watching the people go by and just having a relaxing time. But that had like a coldness suddenly. That I remember at a particular time when we played hopscotch. I remember that very well. And then I remember that I was coming home from school one day, and one of the boys, our elementary school was divided, the boys on one side and the girls on the other, and the school was divided by a very large brick wall. So through the brick wall, we could talk to the boys. I mean, we were just small children. And one boy's name was Jean-Pierre. Jean-Pierre, but I don't remember his last name. And I liked him a lot because he made funny faces all the time. And then he used to walk me home many times because we had to cross a big avenue. And he would walk across. And then suddenly one day, I remember that he pushed me into a door in, how do you call these doors? These big doors like a portal. And he pushed me in there and he beat me up. And he says, "You're a dirty Jew." And I couldn't understand why he did that. And what was strange is that many, many years later, maybe 30 years later, I met him on the street. And I didn't behave very nicely to him.
What did you do?
He stopped and he said, "I want you to meet my wife." He was married, and he said, "Hello," and he says, "Where do you live now?" And I just told him what I thought of him, and it wasn't very nice. And I said, "Don't touch me." He wanted to shake my hand, he reached out like he was going to embrace me, and I said, "Please don't touch me." And I did something that wasn't very nice, but I felt liberated as I told his wife that he was not a very nice person when he was a child. And I walked away. But that was maybe 30 years after. But I never forgot him. I could never forget his face. He was a big disappointment to me because he was a friend, a little friend. And he beat me up. It was such a paradox because he used to protect me to cross the avenue. And then all of a sudden, when he probably heard that the Germans were coming in or whatever, and the conversations at home probably did create this feeling in him. But that he could do that was very unfair to me. That's what I remember from him.
Were you also hearing that the Germans were coming in?
Yes. My father and mother were talking about gathering cash in case we needed to evacuate the place. And I didn't want to hear that. I mean, I couldn't comprehend it very well. And then my father had a meeting with the family, the whole family. And he was sort of the patriarch, with the brothers and everybody, and he said, you have to go into hiding. He had a feeling that it wasn't good. He was listening to the radios and all the papers. And my brothers, he told my oldest brother that he wants him to be in charge of the children, of the boys, and take care of them, that they should leave home. And my oldest brother went into the what is called the Maquis, which was the French underground under General de Gaulle. And he was a medical student when the war broke out, so he went in to help with the military in the medical corps. And he took my brother David with him. They changed their names.
What did they change their names
to? My oldest brother's name was Rambert, which he kept.
And his first name?
Jean-Jacques, a real French name. And David changed, and he had David change his name to David Rousseau. And he kept his name too. Because after the war, they thought that to get into university, it would be better if we didn't have a Jewish name. So that's what they did. So anyway, to go back to that, my oldest brother became later on the rank of a captain in the French underground. And he took David with him so that he could be his orderly, so that they would not be separated. But Maurice didn't want to go. He didn't want to leave my parents. And he stayed with my parents until he went out on the street one day, and we had hours, like I said, when we could be in certain stores or go in the subway. But he was young, he didn't listen, and he said to my parents that he wanted to go to the movies, so he took the subway. And he was arrested in the subway. And they had what they call a razzia. And the Germans walked onto the train, stopped the trains of the subway, and had all the men drop their pants. And each man that was circumcised was taken in to Drancy, which was the pre-camp of the camps that they send you to, like Buchenwald or Auschwitz. And he was sent to Auschwitz, and we received a letter later on that he was killed there. And someone came back and told us that he was put into the oven, to the crematory. So he left one morning in our home, and he never came back. That was that. Then I was playing on the street. I stayed home because I was the youngest.
Oh, you know, before we go to that, I want to ask some questions.
Sure.
First. You said you had this family meeting. Do you remember when that was?
The day?
Either the day, the month, the year. Do you remember? You remember exactly?
It was, no, I don't remember, but it was, no, time was very difficult to identify, to remember, because it happened so quickly. In my mind, it happened very quickly. Everything became like a turmoil. It was like, it was unreal. It still is unreal. It's like this other life never existed. It's like a movie. Not a very good one.
Were you still in school at that time?
Yes. Yes, I was a little girl going to elementary school.
Did anything change at school?
Well, some of the teachers were very protective of the few children that were still going to school, of the Jewish children, because life went on for the other people. But for the Jews, we were very afraid, because everybody was saying you have to be very careful with whom you're talking. If this person is a stranger, don't talk to them. And then the stars came out, where distributed, you know, that everybody had to go to be registered in the city hall as a Jew.
Do you remember that?
Yes.
Do you remember doing that?
Yeah, I remember doing this with my father and mother. And my mother was a very, she was a very low-key person and very shy. And my father took care of everything. So my mother never wrote a check in her life. My father took care of everything. So he said to her, you have to come with me. And she said, why don't you do it? And he says, everybody has to do it. You have to be there. So I went with her and my father. And I couldn't understand why there was a big table there in the entry of the city hall. And people that I used to see on the street that I knew were there and signing us up, because we had to have new identification cards. Everyone in Europe always had, in France, always had, like we have here, a social security card or a driver's license as an identification card. We had just an identification card with where you live, where you were born, if you're a student or working or whatever. And then on that same card, they changed it and they gave it another color. Instead of being, it was like enough beige before, it was a yellow one. And across was a stamp and it said Juif on it, Jew. And it was like, you brand an animal. That's how I felt. Like, I had seen, when I was much younger than that, I had seen how they branded a horse once, and I cried very much because I thought that the horse would be in pain. And I felt exactly like, again, odors, like I almost smelled the flesh of being branded, which was strange because later on, when you read and when you see films of the crematories, how the people said that the odors must have been horrible of the flesh burning. And that's what I remember that marked me very much. And also, They said, stay behind this line. How things come back to you. Then many, many, many years later, of course, when I was in the United States, when you come through customs, they say, stay beyond the yellow line. And the very first time that they told me to present my passport and please stay beyond the yellow line, gave me such a terrible feeling that I almost froze. I couldn't step forward when it was my turn. So a lot of things stay in your mind that seemed so unimportant at the time. So then when we had those cards and they gave us the star, the Jewish star to wear, that we had to have it on all our clothing. So it was, we were branded. We could not go out without having the yellow star sewed on. I remember my mother sewing night and night after night on all our clothing. They gave us a lot of stars. And it said, Juif on it, Jew. It wasn't like you would wear a piece of jewelry.
Do you remember what time of year this was?
It was very cold. I don't remember what time of the year it was, but it was very, very cold. That I remember. And everybody got depressed. My father was a very funny person with a good sense of humor, and suddenly he lost all that. And then, of course, when my brother got deported, then life changed completely at home.
Did the brothers also have to report and wear stars?
They were in, Maurice did, but my two other brothers were in the French underground. They were in the mountains. They were not in the cities.
Were you hearing from them?
Yes. The chief of police of the area was a close friend of my father. So he used to come and warn us about certain things that were going to happen.
And he was a non-Jew?
He was a Gentile, yes, and he was very close to my father. He used to play bridge with him during the war, before the war. And he somehow, I don't know how, but somehow he got messages from my brother, from my oldest brother. And he got messages that he could give to my parents.
Do you remember the name of this man?
Monsieur Dufour. He was a wonderful man. He actually risked his life by doing that. Because he barricaded our home and said that my parents were not living there. And that the house was condemned. But they did live there. And he used to bring them food. On the black market, but he used to bring them food and tell them what the situation was around.
Do you remember his first name?
Marcel Dufour. He was wonderful. He had a very kind, round face, and he was just shocked by what was going on. He felt it was inhumane, what was going on. And we didn't know anything about the camps or anything at the time. But I don't know if he was a pro-Jewish person, but I am sure that the reason that he did that is his morality was so high that he probably thought that it was something so unkind to humanity and proper to treat another person that way. He had a high education also.
By this time, were you seeing Germans in the streets?
Yes.
What was your impression?
They were the invaders. And I used to run away from them. But one day I was playing hopscotch. And because at home we spoke Yiddish, but we spoke German also. My father spoke German also, Hochdeutsch. And I was playing hopscotch in front of the house with my friends, and I had long curly hair, and two Germans walked by, and one of the German officers said, oh, because in the area was so nice that they took the most beautiful homes and they took him for themselves. They opened up the commandature offices and just threw out the people out of their homes and invaded their homes. And the commandature was not far from us, which was a headquarters, one of the headquarters of Paris. And these two officers were walking by, and one, I had long hair, but I had a ponytail. And one said in German, "Das ist ein schönes Kind." That's a beautiful child. And I said, "Danke schön," my reaction was. And he stopped and he said, "How do you know German?" And I don't know what I answered. I don't remember. But the next thing I know is that he was blowing a whistle, and there were trucks around that were just traveling the areas. And suddenly they took me on the truck, and they put me on the truck, and my friends were not put on the truck because I was wearing a coat. It was cold, jacket. And underneath, when he dragged me, underneath I had my Jewish star, which already was wrong because I was supposed to wear the Jewish star on top of my coat. But I had the feeling that it wasn't the right thing to do, that maybe if I didn't wear the star on top, I could be protected. I had that feeling. My parents never told me that. And then they took me on that truck, and I screamed, and I saw my parents from the balcony, and they couldn't do anything.
Do you remember when that was?
No.
Remember how old you were?
Must have been 1940. Must have been five, 6 years old, maybe 41. And it was like I was ripped away. Because I never left my parents. I was too young. We went on vacation together, and I never left my parents. My father wanted to do something. I remember I saw my father from the balcony do something, and the maid dragged, my mother couldn't move. My mother must have been like paralyzed, she couldn't move. But the maid stopped my father from screaming out or doing anything, because we were supposed to be not living there. So the maid was actually saved my parents at that moment, because they would have been taken also. And then they took me to Drancy with that truck, which was the place of triage, you know, where they decided from that camp, which was right outside of Paris, who would go where, Buchenwald or what.
I just want to clarify a few things. By this time, was your father still going to work? Did he have his job?
No, no. I don't remember that.
Do you know, was your family actually in hiding? You said that the
they were in hiding. They did not go out.
But why were you allowed to go out?
I was going to school. I don't know. I don't know, actually, why I was allowed to go out. I was going to school, but I think maybe I had a false name, but I don't remember. Maybe I had another name. I don't remember that.
And was this before or after your brother was picked up? Your brother Maurice?
That's my brother Maurice was gone already. It was before. I mean, after Maurice was taken, and then this happened to me.
Was that a short period of time?
I think so.
And do you recall that, you know, what happened to Maurice? Do you remember being with your parents and hearing this news? I mean,
I only remember that my parents cried terribly, and they said that Maurice went away. And I asked where, because we were very close. We were the two youngest one in age. And he said, and I don't remember what they said, but I knew that he was not coming home. But it was like blocking it out, because I don't remember. Well, I'm jumping from one thing to another, but when I did come back from the war, the first thing that I looked for was my brother Maurice in the house. And I don't remember how I found out that he was killed in Auschwitz. Because I don't remember, was blocked out. He was playing with me all the time because he was the youngest of the three boys. And I remember that before he was picked up, how long before, I can't tell you, but I wanted roller skates, and roller skates were impossible to find. And he went out and bought me roller skates. He brought them. I still have them in Paris. But he really risked his life to buy me those roller skates. He got them on the black market somewhere. But I remember the discussion was going on between my father telling my brother not to go. And he says, if she wants it, she's going to have it. He, you know, I was his little doll, you know. I was just a baby of the family. I was very, very spoiled by my family. Spoiled with love, I mean, you know.
And did you have any contact with your other relatives or know where they were, the cousins, your aunts and uncles?
I knew where my aunt was. My aunt Lily was in the Creuse, which was in the middle in the central part of France. She was in hiding there. My father sent her away. She was married. And her husband was deported, and he took care of her. My father took care of her, and he sent her away.
We'll change tapes here. Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez, can you describe a little bit more what that period was like, where you were hiding in your house, at the time when it was supposed to be abandoned?
Well, for the people on the outside to think that it was condemned, there was no light coming through. And the reason that no light could come through is because the commissaire, the chief of police, had told my, had brought to my parents a navy blue paper that was to be put on all the windows. And it must have been a special paper where the light doesn't go through. So we used very little light in the house, but all the windows were navy, were covered. There was no daylight coming through. And we used low bulbs in the house, and just for the necessity, you know, of it. If we would go from one room to another, you know, we would use the light very sparingly so that not to take a chance. And maybe a little light would come through because they would patrol. The Germans would patrol the houses with big lamps, you know, that they could see through everything.
And you said that, you know, when you were taken, your maid was in the house with your parents.
Yes, what, she never left us.
And what was her name?
Caroline.
And her last name?
I don't know. I think it was Deforge, I think. I don't remember. But her name was Caroline. She was a woman that had no family, so we were her family. She was an orphan.
And did she stay the entire time?
She stayed all the time. She didn't even go out to cook, to buy food or anything, because she was afraid that they would trace her back to our house.
So how was food brought?
By this chief of police. He had someone bring the food, someone from his family. And my father used to give him big amounts of money. I remember that. I used to be surprised of how he peeled out all these big, large bills all the time, my father. For it was black market food, you know. But money was not important. If you had enough of it, it wasn't important because it saved your life. You could buy almost anything. The silence of people, too.
And all your things, your family things, were still in the house?
Everything. Everything was in the house. But we didn't use... We didn't have the same life at all. We never ate in the dining room anymore. We ate in the kitchen. I didn't like that. I always liked to eat in the dining room. And so we were sitting, the four of us, Caroline, my father, my mother and I, and eating. It was very sad. We never laughed anymore. We never had a joke. It was very sad.
Did you keep the holidays still and Shabbat?
I don't think so. I don't remember. I don't think so. Couldn't. There was no one there. I think I remember my mother lighting the Shabbat candles. That, yes. And we didn't eat meat. We only ate fish. Because my mother wouldn't eat meat that wasn't kosher. So during the whole war, we only ate. I mean, they did. Then when I was in hiding, I ate whatever they gave me.
Do you remember when your two older brothers left? Do you remember?
Yes.
saying goodbye.
Yes, it was. My oldest brother said that he was going to the mountains because he liked to ski. And he was taking David with him because he wanted to teach David to ski. And I said, and Maurice is going to go also. And he said, no, Maurice doesn't want to go. So I said, that was good that he could stay with me. I remember that. But I remember that my brothers kissed me so many times, you know, for, as before they used to go away with the Boy Scouts and things like this, and they would always kid around with me and I would run behind them. But this time they kissed me in a very special way, like maybe it was the final, I don't know. I didn't realize why at the time. I didn't see them during the whole war.
And during this period when your family was in hiding, was there anywhere that you would go out, that you could go besides going to school?
I would go with Caroline once in a while, would take me in the dark when it wasn't broad daylight. She would take me down the avenue and around the boulevards to get some air. But we had to run back home because she didn't want to leave my parents alone. But my parents were very scared if I was out. So they felt much better if I was home. And I kept busy at home.
What did you do?
I played games with my mother. And my mother was teaching me how to knit and things like that. And I did a lot of coloring. I can't draw, you know, but I did a lot of coloring, I remember. Paintings, and I made a mess everywhere, you know. It was just probably something to get my mind off. I don't know, they tried to distract me. We listened to the radio. I listened a lot to the radio.
What was on the radio?
The BBC. We could get the English news. And I didn't like that so much because then the music slipped away. And I loved music. I listened to all the records we had. I could spend hours in front of the record player. I had to put it very low, everything very, very low. Maybe that's why today I don't like much noise around me, you know.
And what were your parents telling you? How did they explain things to you?
They didn't. I didn't ask too many questions because I knew that it was very painful to them. I could sense that my parents were suffering a lot. My mother had a very hard time sleeping, and I think my father took up a little bit of drinking, I think, at that time. I mean, not to be drunk, but I think that in the evening when he went to bed, I think he took a shot of schnapps or something. But my mother had a very hard time sleeping. She would walk the floor at night. Her children were gone from the house. Her whole life was her children. She was a special woman. She was an angel. She was not a mother. So it was very hard for her. I think harder for her than for my father. My father was in the war in 1418. So maybe he was a little more hardened. I don't know.
And after Maurice was taken, do you remember them trying to, you know, make any efforts to find him?
Oh, then they went to, they got word to my oldest brother that he was taken, and he tried to find out where he was, and he found out that he was in what convoy he was shipped from Drancy, from where they had taken me. But he couldn't do anything. Nobody could do anything. And my brother threw out a letter. He wrote a letter from the train, and someone was kind enough to put it in the mail. And my mother received it. And he said, in the letter it said that, "I know I'm not going to come back." It was addressed to my brothers. "Please take care of my little sister and my parents." That was it. Sorry. I'm okay.
So is there anything else from that period before you were taken from the street? Anything else you remember? Anything that comes to mind? Any memories?
No, I just remember that we had a very happy life, and suddenly it was cut off. It was just cut off. And like I told you before, they won the war. The Germans definitely won the war, because they marked us in such a way. There isn't a day that goes by that I don't think about my brother. For the mere fact that he was so young, he didn't live, because at 18. In those years, wasn't like 18 today. Children didn't go away from the homes. They were just glued to the parents and to the home life. And he was just taken away one day, and his life was cut off for no reason other than being Jewish. He was a pure child. He was innocent, totally innocent. He was just a good soul, and a devoted child to his parents, to his family, to his country. He loved friends. He was an A student, I remember. He had many friends everywhere. When he passed away, when we found out that he passed away, the people in the neighborhood after the war were just devastated, because he was such a kind human being. There was no reason for that. And I'm not just saying this for my brother, but for all of it, there was no reason. And the way the war marked all of us is something horrible. All of us are marked. And I wasn't in a concentration camp. So the people that were in a concentration camp, like my husband, who still wakes up at night. If you really think about it, you can't go out of your mind. That it is possible that, imagine we are sitting here in my house, that someone should come in now and take us away from each other, and we are just people that met. How painful it would be. So imagine being taken away from your own families for no reason. So I feel that they did win the war. I am incapable of forgiving the people.
Which people?
The German people. I feel that the people such as the Germans, who were so educated, who had such principles. In Europe, among the Jewish people at the time, I remember they were saying that families of wealth would send their daughters to Germany to be living like au pair in a German family so that they can learn the proper way of setting a table or keeping a house or behavior, like a finishing period of time. I can't believe it, that people who were so highly educated and so prim and proper could be convinced by one crazy human being or a beast, can't be a human being, and convinced that this is the thing to do. There were very few Germans that were good people. There must have been some, as we know, like Schindler and people like this. But the majority that, imagining that could never happen in America, that, there would be a revolution, people would never admit you go and you kill people for nothing. I hope not. I want to hope that it can never happen again. That people could be convinced to destroy other people for no matter what reason. It's so sinful. So, I am incapable of buying anything German. Not even a German chocolate cake. When I see the name German chocolate cake, I don't even buy it. It has nothing to do with Germany, but I can't. I read the labels of everything. If a cake is made in Germany, I don't buy it. If a can of worth of $50, 50 cents is made in Germany, I wouldn't buy it. I just can't. I can't cross the country. I will never breathe their air. I feel that the whole country is contaminated even today. Because they were taught that way. Just like we were taught as Jews to do mitzvot, they were taught the opposite. They had to be. Because you learn, you live by what you experience, by what you're teaching your children. And we were taught at home to do only good, That's what we were taught. That's what Judaism is all about. That's what I'm trying to understand. And I'm 63 years old and I can't understand it. I just don't comprehend it. Maybe I'm getting a little too much off the political thing. But I feel pretty strongly about it. I feel just as strong about Israel in the positive way.
Let's go back then, you know, to when you were picked up.
Yes.
What do you remember about that ride in the car with those Germans?
It was cold. And it smelled from cigarettes because everybody was smoking. And then I remember getting to the camp. And I was screaming all the time. And then I lost my voice. I was screaming because I was scared. I was all alone in the middle of a mass of children and people. But I was all alone, and I was very frightened.
What was the camp?
The camp was like a place that that threw us all together there. And we slept on the floor, sitting up, wherever. And we got soup and bread. Soup, well, it was their soup and bread. And we were all thrown together. Adults with children, then the children got separated. We only stayed. I was there only 4 days.
Were you taken directly there by the same car that picked you up?
Yes. I was there only 4 days, and I feel that I was there 4 years. It was the longest days.
What type of buildings were there?
Like barracks that you see on the television, military barracks.
And there were guards?
Yes, everywhere. And dogs. These big dogs that they had. I don't know who barked louder, the dogs or the Germans, but they sounded the same. They couldn't speak. They would never speak to people. They would bark. They did everything to degrade us.
Were there beds to sleep in?
No, they were just mats. Like mats. You know, these we rolled up the mat, and then to make more room, and then when we had to sleep, when they said that we had to go to sleep, whenever they decided to, we had to go to sleep. Could be 2 in the afternoon or midnight. They came in and they said, "This is what we want you to do. Do it, that's all." And to go to the restroom, we had to wait in line. There weren't enough restrooms. There were no accommodations to shower, for sure.
Do you remember what time of year that was?
It was smelly. It was smelly, very bad. No, I don't. but it smelled very bad. Body odors and it was very bad.
Was there anyone there who comforted you or took you under?
No, the children were screaming. We were all children when they separated us. Everybody was screaming, one louder than the other. And then when the Germans came in with the dogs, everybody got quiet because we were scared of them and the dogs.
What were the ages of the children?
And there were children that were twice as tall as I was, and there were children that were smaller than I. I don't know the ages. There were two babies, maybe 8, 9 months old, that a little girl was taking care of. One little girl was taking care of one, and another girl that looked a little older was taking care of the other one. But not for long. I don't know how long they stayed, but not for long.
How many children were you with? Or did you see?
I think there must have been a couple of hundred. I would estimate them, a couple of hundred in my memory.
Did you talk with anyone else?
Yes. We talked and we asked why we were here. And most of them were so frightened that they couldn't even talk. There was a strong smell of urine because the children got scared and they urinated on themselves. Or they couldn't wait to go to the restroom or whatever, but we were very scared. Everybody was frightened. The children were very, very frightened.
What did you do during the day?
I don't know. I don't remember. I don't remember. Certain things just blacked out, you know.
But do you remember anything else from those days?
From the camp, I remember when I saw my brother walking in. That I remember.
Can you describe that?
Well, my brother walked in, Abel, the oldest one. And he was wearing a German uniform. And he spoke very well German because he spoke Hochdeutsch. And he just looked at me. And he was with another German. I don't know if he was German also or if he was French or whatever. And he spoke to two other people in civil clothes and said that he wanted this child and that child. And he just looked at me, and I didn't say anything. I understood that I was supposed to be quiet. And I went with him.
We're going to stop the change of the day.
Cohen-Rodriguez.
Can you get up for a minute? Would you continue?
So my brother walks in, and he tells in German that I should follow. He tells this person in civil clothing that I should follow him with this other child. And he took another child with him and I. And then he took us in a car. And we walked out of the camp. And we never spoke about it again. Ever. I never knew what he did to get the uniform. I don't know. I asked him once, and he said, it's a part of my life that I don't want to speak about ever. But he saved my life. And he didn't bring me back home. He put me in a hiding place. He says, you're going to, and he explained to me. And he took that child too.
Who was that child?
I don't know. I never saw her. He probably just took that child at random, you know, to make it maybe more official or whatever. It was very fast. And then he took me out to this convent, and he explained to me, and he spoke to me for a long time, and he explained to me that I had to stay there because it was safe, and if anything, if a man, I don't remember his name, will contact me, and if that man takes me someplace else, I have to go. But if anybody else wants me to go, I should not go. Only that person. So you grow up very quickly. You understand very quickly, because as soon as I saw him in the camp, my first instinct was to run to him. But I didn't. He looked at me in a certain way, and he never looked at me like this again. He looked at me in a way that was very cold and very sad. And meaning, don't do anything to blow it, you know. So he took me to the convent, and then he stayed overnight with three other men. I think he stayed overnight. Three other men that were from the FFI, which was called the FFI, was the Maquis, the French underground. They had two names, Maquis and FFI.
Do you know the name of the convent?
Sainte-Marie. I know. It was in Savigny. And I stayed there for a while, and then this man came, that I don't remember how he was called. Then my brother had said that I should go with him only. And he took me to a family called Godignon.
How long were you in the convent?
I don't know, maybe a couple of weeks.
What do you remember from that time?
I remember I used to get hit every day because I had a beautiful voice and I was singing in the choir. They put me in the choir and I had to sing the Ave Maria. And I liked it. I liked the music and it was beautiful. I was in the choir. But when you walked into the church, you were supposed to cross yourself. And you were supposed to kneel. Crossing myself and kneeling, I would never do. Because I remember that one Passover we had, and my father's brother was having a conversation with him. And we were many, many around the table. And the only thing that I remember is that my father said in Yiddish that I eat knitnish. And it was like in my mind that if you do kneel, the wrath of God is going to hit you or something.
Would you translate that, that you said in Yiddish?
A Jew doesn't kneel. But he said it in such a way that it was so imperative, so like it was a law. You don't kneel. And a Jew doesn't become drunk. It's not nice to be drunk. And they were talking about whatever. It was a strange conversation, but that's all I picked out. So when I was in the convent, and I would, every time you go in front of the cross, you have to kneel and cross yourself. Well, I wouldn't do it. And that was a terrible disrespect, of course, for them. And the Mother Superior came and said to me, you must do it. And I said, no, I'm not allowed to do it. And they said, but this is what you have to do. And I said, I won't do it. And I didn't. So I was beaten every day, but I didn't do it. I just took it so seriously, you know. They wanted me to also, not just me, but there were three other Jewish children. The other children did kneel and cross. One girl was called Nicole, and the other one was Janine, and they did, and it was fine. You know, I said, do it if, you know, my father told me not to do it. But my father didn't tell me not to do it, but this is how I understood it.
Did you have contact with your parents at that time?
None whatsoever. But I knew they were okay. And I felt better knowing that they were safe. Maybe it's the other door.
So, how many children were there in the convent besides you and the two other girls that you talked about?
Oh, it was a school. It was a regular school. And they had just a few Jewish children. But other than that, it was all right. You know, there was nothing happening terribly wrong there.
So do you remember leaving?
Yes, I left. I remember they came to get me in a car. And this man that my brother had told me about. And then he took me to the Godinho, the family Godinho.
And who were they?
They were a Gentile family that wanted to keep two Jewish children for a very high price. And my father paid every month a lot of money. I don't know how much, but it was a lot of money.
How did you know that?
Because later on we spoke about the fact that I was starving. And my father was outraged because he said whatever they asked, if they would ask a certain amount of money, he would give double to make sure that I would have everything I needed.
Would you tell me about this family?
He was a wonderful man, and she was very nasty, the wife. And they had two daughters that were married, and the husbands of the daughters were prisoner of war. And She was very nasty, the woman.
What was her name?
I don't know. I called her Madame Godignon. He was a wonderful man. He was very kind, and he used to take me for walks in the forest. It was in the countryside.
Do you remember his first name?
No. We wouldn't dare call him by his first name. We don't do that in France.
Or the daughters?
The daughters were married, but they didn't live with us.
Do you remember their first name?
Marie-France and Françoise. They were very unhappy because their husbands were taken as prisoners. They said that they were anti-German, so they were taken in. They were good people. But she was nasty as a person, personality. She was barking also. She wasn't very feminine.
And who else was there besides you?
Two other girls.
And who were they?
Nicole and Jenny.
Do you know their last names?
No.
So can you tell me a little bit about life with that family?
I was going to school. I was supposed to be a Gentile. The whole town thought that I was a Gentile child. That my father was a prisoner of war or something. They made up a story. I was going to school. I had a normal life for a child without parents, you know, but I mean went to school in the morning, came home at lunchtime, went back to school and then did the chores of the house that they asked us to do. And we lived like almost normal people.
And at that point, had you had any contact with your parents? Did you have letters or
nothing?
Do you remember what year this was?
That was in 1943. I had no contact with them at all. Then one time, my mother came to see me. She really risked her life to come. She was without the star, and she brought me a cake that she made at home. And I saw her very little. I saw her at the train. He took me, the man, Mr. Godignon, took me to the train, and he says, your mother is going to come and see you, but she cannot come here. It's too far from the train. So she came to see me at the train, and I didn't want to let her go. She was very brave. She didn't cry, nothing. She just was touching me all over, feeling me, if everything was in one piece. And she left. But she explained to me why she was not coming, and I knew, I understood. And she wanted to know how Abel took me out of the camp. Was he wearing civilian clothes? And I said, I don't know. I didn't want her to know. I thought that it wouldn't be good if she knew. I made my own conclusion. And later on, my brother said that it was very heroic on my part to lie to her. But it was the right thing to do. I don't think my parents ever knew that part, that he came in a German uniform. I really don't. We never spoke about it.
Were you close to the two other girls that you were with?
Yes. But nothing special. Because after the war, I never saw them again. We didn't keep in touch.
So is there anything else you recall from living with his family?
Yes, that we were deprived of love that we needed as children, except by this man who gave us a lot of affection, but behind her back, because she was very strict. But she, you see, today it might be taken as a strange thing for a man to come, a stranger like that, to come to our beds and tuck us in and give us a kiss. It might be misunderstood, but it was strictly because he wanted to make us feel comfortable. He was very nice. He used to give us even once in a while a candy. But she was not a nice person.
Did you go to church with him?
No. I refused to go. But they didn't force me. They were not big churchgoers, so it was okay.
What did he do for a living, Matt?
He was not working. He was a retired man. And he was not working, but he did a lot of work around the house. And he loved to garden. And he was a handy person, you know. Had a beautiful house. We had beautiful rooms to live in. It was nice. And the trees, the forest was close by. We were breathing fresh air. The odors were nice there. But there was a big emptiness. And when we went to bed, the three of us were sleeping in one bedroom. We had a nice room, big room. And we were sleeping together, the three. We used to talk a lot about I don't know what. And we were reading under the covers like normal kids do. I think it was about the only time during the war that it was a normal.
How long were you with him?
For 3 years. And many, many, many years later, maybe I think about 10 years ago, I went back there to see the house. And it's a thing that no one should do. It brings back memories and everything changes. It doesn't look the same. The scale of things is different. That house was so humongous to me. It was just a little house, but it looked humongous, you know.
Were they alive?
No.
When you went back?
Young people were living there. And I asked them if I could go in to see my room, but my room wasn't there anymore because they built up whatever. And they were nice. I told them why I wanted to come, and they invited me for lunch, and they were very nice people.
Why do you say one shouldn't go back?
Because you have an image of something. And you should keep it that way because it gets destroyed. Maybe not destroyed, but it gets distorted. Then it was fine. And as an adult, when you go back, it's not fine. You see a lot of things that are not what you thought they were.
So is there anything else you recall that you wanted to say about that period with the family?
I didn't like Christmas because I missed Hanukkah. So I called it Hanukkah with the two other girls. But the two other girls didn't know what Hanukkah was. They were not very Jewish. Being Jewish, they were not. So we called it the Red Hanukkah, because everything was in red.
So do you remember when you left that home?
Oh, yes.
Can you describe that?
Oh, yes.
The day you left?
The house had several steps to go down. And he, Monsieur Godignon, came and told me the war was over. We heard that the Germans capitulated and that the Americans were coming into the outskirts of Paris. And he said, your father is coming to get you. And I couldn't believe it. What does capitulate mean? What does, you know, I didn't know all this. And anyway, all of a sudden my father came. He was not driving. My oldest brother was there. In uniform, and it was a official French car from the government.
What uniform?
He was wearing the French uniform, the De Gaulle uniform. And because De Gaulle walked in as the liberator of France.
And this was your brother?
Abel, my oldest brother. He came with two orderlies that he had. But David wasn't there. David was in another car, but behind him, with other men, also in uniform.
What was the name of this village that you were in?
Épinay-sur-Orge.
And how far was that from Paris, do you know?
With the train, 25 minutes. Okay. And then the car number was, it was a Citroën. And the car number, the plate number was 8888, 48. And my brother was driving, and he came out, and it was like God himself came. And my father was sitting in the front, squeezed in with my mother and three people in the back. And they were smoking cigarettes. My mother never smoked. My father never smoked in his life. They were smoking cigarettes. And I was sitting in the back. They put me in the back with those three other people and a big pillow. And they put me on the pillow like I was broken or something. And then the fire started. When we drove away, I kissed them goodbye. Monsieur and Madame Godignon, I kissed them goodbye. When we drove away, my father, who was never a smoker, threw the cigarette out. And the windows were open and the car caught on fire. Not the car, but the pillow caught on fire. And I remember driving to Paris and seeing how Paris looked so devastated. And coming home. And when I came home, I asked where Maurice was. And I looked everywhere for him. And I couldn't find him, because they had told me that David was in the car behind and he was coming a little later. So I was trusting it was fine. But I don't remember what happened after that. I looked for Maurice and I couldn't find him. I looked everywhere for him. In the house, we had a cellar, in the cellar, everywhere I couldn't find him. And I don't remember how they told me. I thought he was playing with me. Hide and seek, you know. Because when they came to get me, I asked, where was David? And they told me. And then I said, where is Maurice? And nobody answered me. But in the rushing of getting into the car and saying goodbye to the other people and to the children that were there with me, I don't remember what happened.
Who were the other people in the car? You said there were three people in the back.
There were soldiers. My brother was a captain, and there were soldiers. They were driving back from the Savoie, where they were in the mountains. They were in Annecy. That was it.
So then what were those next years like in Paris after the war?
It's strange to go back into a normal life. It seemed to me it was very difficult. And our family life wasn't the same anymore. A lot of our family was missing. A lot of brothers of my father were gone. Their wives were gone, the children. Some children were saved and some weren't. And it was not the same, ever. In our immediate family, in our home, it could never be the same, because one of us was missing. So it was always there. There was always a sadness in the house. Even if there was a joyful event, there was a sadness. And there was always a candle lit in the house. Always a yahrzeit. Always, if it went out, another one went on. And my mother wanted it on forever. She wouldn't get an electric one, but she wanted that one, that type. It was probably for the whole family, or for the 6 million.
Did you go back to keeping holidays and Shabbat?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. It was hard. My family, it was hard. But I did whatever they wanted me to do, you know. But it wasn't the same. It has never been the same again. The only thing that we still have is the closeness of the family. It was very, very close. My brothers and I were like one. Always. We never had any difference of saying, this is mine and this isn't mine. And their money was my money was their money, my clothes, if they wanted to wear, you know, whatever. Whatever we had was together. And it's still like that. My brother and I are just the same, still.
We'll stop here to change tape. Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez, could you tell me what happened in the next few years, what happened to the people in your family?
Well, my oldest brother, Abel, got married to a girl that he knew before the war.
And what's her name?
Sarah.
And her last name? Maiden name?
Settner. And they were childhood sweethearts. And they found each other after the war, so they got married. And they lived 6-7 minutes away from my parents. Then my brother David wanted to go to America. First of all, my father went to America right after the war. He had an uncle, a nephew here in New York. And he came back. He was here for about 3 months. Came back and he said that in America it was, there were a lot of opportunities for young people and things like this as a conversation. So David wanted to be a Hollywood star. He was very handsome. And he wanted to be a Hollywood star because he was a fabulous dancer. So he came to America. He came to my, we called him our uncle, but it was my cousin actually. It was my father's nephew in New York.
And what's his name?
His name was Irvin Casher. And he was a manufacturer of children's sweaters in New York. And he did an affidavit for David. And David moved to Canada first and then to the United States. And he moved to Los Angeles. He came in Los Angeles and he opened up the dancing school. He was not discovered as a movie star as he thought he would be. And he came and he opened up a dancing school and came back to Paris on one trip and offered me to come to Los Angeles. I was a student then on a vacation. So I came on the ship with him. We took the ship from Le Havre to New York and it was a magnificent trip.
What year was that?
That was in 55. And my parents said, go, it'll be a beautiful trip, you know, just on a vacation, and I never went back. And I met a young man from New York and I got married.
And his name?
His name is Robert Lazaruk. And I got married to him after knowing him. I came in July. And we got married in March. And I got a beautiful boy from him, a son.
And his name?
Kirk.
And when was he born?
He was born in Cedars of Lebanon at the time, here in L.A.
In what year?
1958. That was the best thing that ever happened in my life, was the day he was born. The second best thing was when his son was born. And after a few years, I divorced his, Kirk's father. And I went back to Paris just to visit. And in 1962, I married Jack, my present husband.
And his full name?
His full name is Jack Cohen-Rodriguez. Kirk kept his name. And now Kirk is married and to a girl called Samantha, a beautiful blonde girl with blue eyes, and a very nice girl. And we have a grandchild.
What's your grandchild's name?
Jacob David. And he was born 26th of September of this year, 98. He's a very special child.
Did your parents ever come to the United States?
My mother came several times, and my mother stayed with us for several times, and the last time that she was with us, she stayed for 4 years. My dad had died.
When did your father die?
My father died 12 years before. This is strange. My mother died in 1984. And my father died 12 years before that.
And how did they fare in living in Paris after the war? Did your father go back to his work?
Yes, he went back to his work with not the same way of living at all. This heavy sadness was there all the time. So my parents didn't mind too much that, my mother particularly didn't mind too much that her children left home to find a new life. Maybe we would forget.
And where are your parents buried?
In Paris.
Is there any memorial or marker for your brother who died?
Well, we made... there wasn't anything. There isn't anything anywhere. So... after my father and mother died, I asked my brothers if we could put up, we have a family plot, if we could put something up on the marble for Maurice, because to at least make a mark that he was living at one time, and we did. So he is in the... on the marble of the cemetery. In Europe, you put the picture of the people that are deceased. So his picture is the first one. And then my dad, and then my mother. And now there'll be my brother David, passed away a year and a half ago.
You said before that you didn't speak with your brother Abel about what happened to you. Was there anyone that you could talk to after the war? Did you talk with your parents about, you know, your experiences? And later on, did you speak with your first husband, your second husband?
With my brothers, we spoke a lot. But we never spoke about that. The fact that he came... We spoke about the fact that he came and he brought me out, and that was it. He never wanted to know more. We shouldn't speak too much about it. And David didn't want to talk about it at all, because from all of us, the most sensitive person. So he never wanted to discuss that. To him, it was horrible that the whole thing happened. The whole war was so horrible to him, more so than even to me, I think. He was very marked by it.
Were you able to talk to your children?
Well, of course I did. But we never made it... dramatic. We didn't have the children didn't have a life of saying that I live in a home of survivors, you know. I don't think so, because my husband didn't talk about it. Jack didn't talk about it, unless very lightly. He never made it too intense until much, much later.
He was a survivor?
He's a survivor of Bergen-Belsen.
And I wanted to ask you, is your Judaism important to you now, at this time in your life?
Oh, yes. It was always important. Judaism is very important to me.
And are you involved now in any organizations and or
yes,
projects?
I am.
Can you talk a little bit about that?
Well, I'm mostly involved in my own synagogue. The rabbi of the synagogue, Rabbi Philip Schroit, is a personal friend. He was a very, very close friend of my brother David. So it goes back since 1955.
And what synagogue is that?
B'nai David Judea in Los Angeles.
How are you involved with him?
I'm an officer of the synagogue for many years, and I have been president of the sisterhood for many years also. And it's just my second home. I have the keys of the office like I have the keys of my home. So it's my own. I do volunteer work there all the time. The synagogue is very important. My children were bar mitzvah there because I have a stepson. His name is Alan. And he was bar mitzvah there. He went to a Hebrew school there with Kirk and was bar mitzvah and had confirmation there. So it's home.
And why did you feel it was important to make this tape and to tell the story of what happened to you?
That hopefully it will never happen again. And that the children of the next generation should know, to be aware that if any anti-Semitism rises up, to resist it, that it should not come as a surprise to them, and to fight back for their beliefs, the belief of Judaism. They should be strong in their convictions and be with integrity for their religion, for their people. Because we are not just a religion, we are a people. Proud people and very capable people. And we have given a big contribution to the world. So they have to continue that. And no atrocity should ever happen again. Not just to the Jewish people, but to humankind. So now that we were taken by surprise in 1939 because we didn't know that such horrible things could happen. But if the tapes are here and if they are taught in the schools and that the world is aware of it, then, you know, it's like when you start coughing, you think you're getting a cold, you're going to take some medication to prevent the catastrophe of pneumonia. And we have to prevent the pneumonia of the world. And I hope that I want my grandson, and if I have other grandchildren, if we are blessed with other grandchildren, that he should live in a peaceful world. And we paid a very high price to have Israel, that they should be identified with Israel very strongly. It was the highest price that any people can pay. The Israeli flag is very important. That's the reason.
Before we end the tape, is there anything else that you'd like to add or say? Anything we might have left out that you think was important?
Well, you know, I cannot tell you my whole life story in a short time. But in conclusion, I can tell you that I have never been sorry of being a Jew. I was never ashamed of it or embarrassed of it. I was very proud of it. Until my dying day, I will be proud of it. And I hope my children will be too. And I'm happy to be in this country and to be able to do things for my people.
I want to thank you very, very much.
I thank you.
Mrs. Cohen-Rodriguez, would you introduce your family?
This is my husband, Jack Cohen-Rodriguez.
Hello. I'm happy to say a few words, and mainly the fact that we know a lot of people that were survivors. We managed through the years to have somewhat of a life, but of course the tragedy was so overwhelming that we are never able to completely shake it. But I must say that we have managed somehow to pull together and make somewhat of a life for ourselves.
My husband is a survivor of Bergen-Belsen himself, and he did tapes also for the
Shoah.
For the Shoah. That's all you want to say?
Yes.
Okay. This is my son, Kirk Maurice Lazarek.
Hi, I'm Kirk, and I think it's being a second generation, me, a child of a surviving family, there was quite a bit to learn, and there was quite a few issues that come up that probably the average family in America doesn't come across. I don't want to say it was tough, because that really wasn't the emphasis of the family, but I think there's certain things that my parents lost in their childhood, mainly their childhood, and the innocence of a childhood, that transported to my brother and myself. And I think our family handled it pretty well, but there were always issues. And I think several things came out of that. And I think one of them is a greater awareness of our Jewish heritage, which in Los Angeles can easily get masked into the multicultural aspects here. I think the other thing is giving us a heritage that we can pass on to our children, and our wives and our rest of our family. It's been interesting trying to relate to my European cousins, because I really don't know how they deal with it. I think they deal with it in a different way than we have, maybe because they live still in the environment over there, but they don't talk very much about it, and they don't really incorporate it in our discussions at all. It's sort of, that was what happened to our parents, and we've moved on. I think one of the greatest things that happened was a couple years ago, we had a reunion of my dad and his surviving children that were over at the camp, and we were able to make friends with other second generations. And those bonds were spontaneous, and they've become some of our closest friends, even though we might only see them every other year. It's the same as if they were living in our environment and as if they're family. And I think the best victory is surviving. I think that is the true test of whether the Shoah was a victory for those that tried to wipe us out or not, and that's us moving forward and surviving and being mensch about it. That's really about it. And I'm proud of my parents. They've taught me a lot about strength and how to deal with adversity. And I'm sure I'm sure I'll be able to pass it on to my children.
Thank you.
Sure, thank you.
These two pictures are my grandfather's. On the left is my grandfather and my grandmother from my father's side. They were from Krakow, Poland. What date these pictures were taken, I don't know. It was most probably in the middle of... before the war, before 1930 or something like that. I would estimate 1930.
And their family name?
As well as Rosenberg.
And do you know their first names?
No, I don't. Yes, I do. Excuse me, I do. My grandmother, his name was Miriam because I was named after her. But my grandfather, I didn't know. This is my family, my mother in the background holding me. And on the left is my oldest brother, Abel. David is in the center, and Maurice is the youngest one. And that was taken in the countryside, someplace in France. On the left is my brother Maurice Rosenberg. Next to him is Abel Rosenberg, my father Chaim Rosenberg, and my brother David Rosenberg. That was before the war.
And where was it taken?
It was taken in Châtelaillon, which is a seaside shore, a seaside resort, where we were going on vacation all the time before the war. This is my brother Maurice Rosenberg. That was taken, that's the picture of the identification card that he had during the war. It must have been taken probably in 1940, 41.
And where was it taken?
In Paris, France. I think so. This picture is a school picture taken, I believe, in 1947. I am in the middle between, in the third row, between the two teachers who are sitting, and the dark dress with the braids on top. I was wearing braids.
Can you say your name?
And Michele Rosenberg. That was the junior high, actually. Must have been junior high. Equivalent to junior high in the States.
And where was it taken?
In Neuilly, in Paris. This picture represents my family also. On the left side is my father, Chaim Rosenberg. In the center, my brother David Rosenberg and my mother, Hannah Rosenberg. They were walking in the Bois de Boulogne in Paris. This is much, much later. Actually, this picture has been taken 3 weeks before my mom passed away. It's in my brother's house in Paris. Abel is in the center, Abel Rosenberg, with his first grandchild, Philippe, his grandchild. And my mother is on the left. Her name was Hannah. That was taken... 2 weeks before she passed away.
In what year?
In 1984. This is a picture of my son, Kirk, with his wife, Samantha. The day after their wedding, which was the 19th of May, 2 years ago. And this is my grandson, Kirk's and Samantha's child. His name is Jacob David Lazarek. And he was born on the 26th of September, 1998. So he's just here, I think he's 3 days old.
And where was this picture taken?
This picture was taken in his house in Los Angeles. This is my other son. His name is Alan Cohen-Rodriguez. And that was his confirmation picture taken at B'nai David Judea in Los Angeles. That was 30 years ago.
More than 30.
No. This is me coming. I was on a swim team in Paris, and I was coming out of the pool, and the team's name was Hippocamp, which is a sea lion. It's called the Sea Lion Club, the team rather. And that was in 19... I was 16 years old. I can't count that much. I was 16 years old at that time in Paris.